Viewers, a very warm welcome to this special show of On the Front. Today we have a very special guest. I've interviewed him earlier when he was the ambassador of US to Pakistan at a very critical juncture when Osama bin Laden was captured and killed. None other than Mr. Cameron Munter. A very warm welcome. You're also the president and CEO of East West Institute of New York City since 2015. He was a professor of international relations at Pomona College in Claremont and taught at Columbia University School of Law. It's a privilege to have you here.
Privilege to be here. And it's great to have the chance to be back in Pakistan to learn about the things that have changed since my departure in 2012.
I'll go to the Prime Minister Imran Khan and his version and his approach towards US relations. But can we go back to the history a little bit?
جب میری آپ سے آخری ملاقات ہوئی تھی اور آپ پاکستان میں امریکہ کے سفیر تھے تو آپ کے سفارتی دور میں اسامہ بن لادن پکڑا گیا ہماری طرف سے شدید احتجاج کیا گیا کیونکہ ہمیں اطلاع ہی نہیں دی گئی تھی آپ نے وہ سارے واقعات خود دیکھے میں خاص طور پہ بات کر رہا ہوں دنوں کی جب اسامہ بن لادن کو پکڑا گیا اور ایک آپریشن میں ان کو پکڑ مارا گیا ہمارے لیے بہت حیران کن تھا کیونکہ پاکستان امریکہ کا اہم اتحادی تھا اور ہم 9/11 کے بعد سے دہشت گردی کے خلاف جنگ لڑ رہے تھے ہماری عسکری اور سیاسی اسٹیبلشمنٹ اس حوالے سے آگاہ ہی نہیں تھے آپ نہیں سمجھتے کہ امریکہ کا یہ نہایت نامناسب ایٹیچیوڈ تھا اعتماد کا سنگین فقدان تھا کہ آپ نے پاکستان کو اس آپریشن کے بارے میں آگاہ ہی نہیں کیا
ویری ان یوزول اور اٹس ا ایکسٹریم لیول آف ٹرسٹ ڈیفیسٹ ان پاکستان دیٹ یو ڈونٹ ایون ٹیل دیم
سو انفارچونیٹ بیکاز آئی فائنڈ دیٹ دیئرز ا کائنڈ آف ا نیچرل افینیٹی مائی ریلیشن ود پاکستانیز از آلویز ویری پازیٹیو سو ٹو نو دیٹ دیئر واز دس ٹرسٹ دیٹ ہیڈ بلٹ اپ اوور دی ایئرز اٹ واز ایز یو سے very difficult, very, very hard. I would commend to you a book by the American academic Stephen Cole, C-O-L-L.
The author of Ghost Wars.
He wrote the book Ghost Wars, which takes up to 2001, to 9/11. Mm-hmm. His continuation of that story is called Directorate S, and this was the word that the Americans used for the ISI Directorate that was working on some of the issues about terrorism. This outlines a very, very detailed picture of the difficulties that the Americans and the Pakistanis had, the difficulties of understanding the issues and the difficulties of agreeing about the fight on terrorism.
امریکہ کو کیا شک تھا جس کے تحت انہوں نے پاکستان کو اسامہ بن لادن کے خلاف آپریشن متعلق کچھ نہیں بتایا.
Everything will be get exposed and they will fail. What is the doubt?
I mean, I think the doubt was whether or not the Americans would be in control of the operation. And the Americans were in control of the operation.
Yeah, but Pakistan was also...
Pakistan خود اسامہ بن لادن کو پکڑنے کی کوشش کر رہا تھا اور ہم امریکہ سے امداد بھی لے رہے تھے ہم نے اپنی جانیں بھی قربان کی اور ہماری معیشت کو نقصان بھی پہنچا کیونکہ ہم پر جوابی حملے ہو رہے تھے تو پاکستان کو اگر اسامہ کے آپریشن کے متعلق بتا دیا جاتا تو آپریشن مزید کامیاب ہو سکتا تھا
So why on earth if Pakistan would be on your side, if you would have communicated them, the operation would be unsuccessful?
Well, as you know, there was that tradition of mistrust. And it built, I think, from the very time of the earlier decisions that were made right after the 9/11 raid. You know, it's clear, and I hope people in Pakistan know, that Americans understand how many people were turned over to the Americans shortly after the war in Afghanistan began by the Pakistanis. So this is not just a black and white picture. There was cooperation between the Americans and the Pakistanis throughout. But there were also incidents of non-cooperation and that made it very, very uneven. That's why it didn't work out.
Mr. Munter, aapko Osama bin Laden ki Pakistan mein maujoodgi kab pata chala?
Well, I was aware that we were looking hard. And if you see the movie Zero Dark Thirty, mm-hmm. you know, the movie that describes that, it describes that there was a long intelligence trail mm-hmm. of trying to find out
امریکہ کو تو اس بات کا بہت پہلے سے پتا ہوگا کہ وہ پاکستان میں آپریشن کریں گے اسامہ بن لادن کے خلاف What do you say?
To Pakistan.
Again, there's a lot in the written literature that describes this, and it shows that there were you know, reports of couriers who were going to the house in Abbottabad. There were, you know, these ideas. Where was he after 2006, 2005? What were the traces of finding him? And again, I'm using the movie as an example. Yeah, what I found in the movie was very convincing.
But there's a question.
Yeah.
لیکن یہاں سوال یہ پیدا ہوتا ہے کہ آپ اس وقت سفیر تھے تو میں فلم کا ریفرنس تو نہیں لوں گا کیونکہ اس وقت سارے معاملات میں آپ کنٹرول میں تھے اور آپ میرے سامنے بیٹھے ہیں تو آپ بتائیں نا آپ کو کب معلوم ہوا
I have to be the ex-diplomat that I was. Do you know the what we always say the difference is between a journalist and a diplomat? Do you know that? Okay. A diplomat knows many things that he doesn't say. A journalist says many things that he doesn't know.
That's what I would like to ask you. Tell me and inform me about that. So I should also tell
no.
about
In this
it.
Particular case, one of the things that's interesting, as you may know, is when I retired from the diplomatic service, I was asked, are you going to write a book? Are you going to write a book about this? Because it's a very interesting kind of set of stories. Not only Osama bin Laden, but the questions about the Raymond Davis case. What about the Salalah incident? What really happened there? As a diplomat, I have made commitments that I don't talk in public about certain things where I've signed documentation that would expose this.
Okay.
So I would end up writing a book for you that you would say, how come this book is so boring, right? So that's the way it has to be.
So I think...
लोग अभी भी यही कहेंगे कि इंटरव्यू कितना बोरिंग है, मिस्टर कैमरॉन मंटर कुछ बता ही नहीं रहे.
Well, I will only tell you that I appreciate Pakistan so much more after knowing you and other journalists and the way that you guys operate.
Okay, Mr. Mantar, tell me something about...
आप एटलीस्ट इतना तो बता सकते हैं ना कि आपने सबसे पहले मिलिट्री लीडरशिप को पाकिस्तान में कब आगाह किया ऑपरेशन के बारे में जब ओसामा बिन लादेन को पकड़ा गया?
Was captured or was killed? Were you the first?
No, it was actually Admiral McMullen.
Okay.
And not McMullen, Admiral Mullen.
He told Kiani?
He called Kiani.
General Ishfaq Kiani का क्या रद्दअमल था?
Well, I don't know what the reaction was for that. But I went to visit General Kiani and General Pasha
the next
day? Morning. Yes,
okay.
I did.
And what was the reaction?
And the first words they said was congratulations.
All right, okay. Mm-hmm. And with warmness or with satire?
They were exhausted because they'd been up all night.
Okay. So they got to know about it.
So military leadership ko operation ka America se pata chala. Osama bin Laden ke mutalliq bahut se itraazat ne janm liya. کیا آپریشن اسی دن ہوا تھا یا اس سے پہلے اسامہ کو مار دیا گیا تھا ٹورا بورا میں کیا آپ نے اسامہ بن لادن کی ڈیڈ باڈی دیکھی ہے اس کی کوئی تصویریں یا ویژولز
That's not something I'd like to comment about.
Okay.
But one thing that I think is important is that there was, again, in the press, a very important book by, or an article by Seymour Hersh. And he made a very, what I thought, circumstantial case that Pakistan and America had worked together on this, mm-hmm. that they disposed of the body together, all these kinds of conspiracy theories.
Okay.
And I'm not a big fan of conspiracy theories. Mm-hmm. I choose to believe
You could clarify it by saying that whether you have seen the picture or not.
Exactly. But in this particular case, I can only tell you, I think that what Seymour Hersh has written is so off base, and it hurts because I've always respected him as a journalist, but it's off base.
So aapke mutabik Osama bin Laden ko usi raat maar diya gaya?
That night.
He was killed that night, and the account that the Americans gave, that the body he was shot at Abbottabad, that his body was taken back to Afghanistan, and that his body was given the proper Muslim
funeral,
and he was buried at sea off the coast of Pakistan. That's what happened.
Why didn't
aap logon ne Osama ki laash ko dafnaya kyun nahi? Kisne mashwara diya ki unko samundar burt kar diya jaye?
Whose idea it was, but I agree with the idea that you never want to create a shrine to a criminal, right? You never want, if someone has committed a terrible crime, and people who are sympathetic with that person come to a place and worship it, it's along the lines of what would it be if there were a place where people were worshiping Hitler in his body, right? The same thing was true. There was I wasn't part of these conversations, but I think it's important that you don't have a shrine to someone like that.
What was the role of Shakil?
Shakil Afridi ka kya kirdaar hai is sare operation mein? کیا اس نے واقعی اسامہ کو پکڑنے میں کوئی بہت بڑی مدد کی یا اس کا کردار بھی ایک سازشی تھیوری کا حصہ ہے کیونکہ امریکہ پاکستان پر شکیل افریدی کو حوالے کرنے کے لیے دباؤ ڈالتا ہے
ان بارگن ایوری ٹائم ان یو ایس ٹرائز ٹو بارگن وِد پاکستان دے آلویز پٹ شکیل افریدی ریٹرن ٹو یو ایس اور ٹو ہینڈنگ اوور
دیٹس سم تھنگ آئیڈ ریدر ناٹ کمنٹ اباؤٹ
اوکے دس از نو کمنٹ فرام یو کین یو ٹیل
کیا آپ ہمیں ریمنڈ ڈیوس کے متعلق کچھ بتائیں گے کہا جاتا ہے کہ امریکہ نے متاثرہ خاندان کو دیت کی رقم فراہم کی اور کہا جاتا ہے کہ سب کچھ پاکستانی حکومت کے کہنے پر ہوا
So whose account was accurate?
We worked closely with the Pakistani government mm-hmm. to make sure that this wouldn't turn into an international incident. That is, well, it turned into an incident. But the fact that he had diplomatic status, mm-hmm. but that diplomatic status was ignored in Pakistan and that his immunity mm-hmm. under the Vienna Convention for diplomats could have been violated was something that I think friends of America in Pakistan and friends of Pakistan in America didn't want to see. Because as you remember, they wanted to give him the death penalty. Mm-hmm. And that's the kind of thing that can lead to very serious problems along the lines of what we had in Tehran in 1979.
If Raymond Davis would have been...
اگر ریمنڈ ڈیوس کو سزائے موت مل جاتی تو کیا امریکہ پاکستان کے خلاف اعلان جنگ کر دیتا؟
could have waged war against Pakistan?
Very serious.
Like,
very
including
serious.
War?
Well, imagine the relationship that America has had with Iran because of the violation of diplomatic
status.
Like
putting Islamic sanctions?
Yeah. But in other words, I would say that since 1979, it's been a very unhappy story between America and Iran. Anytime you violate international law so egregiously, it has huge consequences. So people on both sides wanted to make sure that didn't happen. Fortunately, in Pakistan, as you know, there is the parallel system whereby the decisions under Sharia law are respected by the secular court. And when that was worked out, then they were allowed legally.
अच्छा तो इसका मतलब ये हुआ कि अमेरिका ने कसास की कोई रकम या दियत की कोई रकम अदा नहीं की?
As far as I know, the US government did not.
Okay. So it's all arranged by Pakistan government. How did you bring them under that pressure?
जब ये वाकया रोनुमा हुआ उस वक्त मीडिया ने इसके मुतालिक बहुत बात की और इसको कौमी यकजहती के साथ जोड़ा गया. आपकी हुकूमत ने किस तरह जरदारी हुकूमत पर दबाव डाला ताकि आप अपना काम ले सके उनसे?
Actually, to succumb to your pressure and do whatever you wanted to.
I would describe it as that we worked with the Pakistani government to make sure that we wouldn't have an international incident.
But earlier they took a very sharp step.
लेकिन क्या इसके बाद आपने पाकिस्तान की मिलिट्री को एतमाद में लिया?
Military, and then you asked them for the.
We worked with elements of the government in Pakistan to make sure that this didn't get out of hand. Yeah.
You know, in these two, three incidents.
आपके दौर में बहुत से अहम वाकयात रोनुमा हुए जैसा उसामा बिन लादेन की हलाकत, रेमंड डेविस केस, लाला पोस्ट पर हमला. आपको कब महसूस हुआ कि दोनों ममालिक अमेरिका और पाकिस्तान जंग की तरफ जा रहे हैं?
Thought we were at the brink of war with Pakistan. What I was very concerned about was that I had come to Pakistan at a time when after the the end of Musharraf's time, the beginning of the new return to democracy, where many people in the United States government had wanted to build a new and better relationship. You remember Kerry Lugar Berman?
Yeah.
These are three members of our Congress who wanted to say...
Kerry Lugar Bill, right?
Yeah, Kerry Lugar Berman. We want to get past those problems of the past where we're only talking about terrorism. Let's talk about assistance. Let's talk about education. Let's talk about a broader relationship.
Yeah, but there was the entire...
Kerry Lugar Bill, Pakistan ki military ke mukhalif tha, puri awam mein iska shadeed radd-e-amal tha, aur fauj mein bhi radd-e-amal tha. उस बिल के जरिए आप पाकिस्तानी हुकूमत से हर वो काम करवाना चाहते थे जो आपकी हुकूमत की ख्वाहिश थी.
That way, what we hoped is that we could work with the Pakistani government and our assistance program, which was $7.5 billion.
Yeah.
You know, we were going to the government of Pakistan saying, "What are your priorities?" We wanted to show that kind of respect. Now, the fact, did it work? Sadly, not. We had a very broad set of relations, and this gets back to your question about would there be war. It's not a question of would there be war, but there was enormous disappointment that this effort to try to fix the relationship under Richard Holbrooke, who sadly died before 2011, but that we would lose the chance, and we did lose the chance at that time, to build the relationship. So my concern, when there was the Raymond Davis case, when there was the Osama bin Laden raid, when we had the Salalah raid, my big concern at that time was we're losing the chance to have an honest and open and respectful relationship because of these incidents. And it was very serious. And it was.
Is it not very confusing for you?
क्या आप उस वक्त उलझन का शिकार नहीं थे? क्योंकि जब ज़रदारी हुकूमत आई तो आप पॉलिटिकल गवर्नमेंट के साथ बातचीत करते थे, लेकिन फिर आपको एहसास हुआ कि असल बात अस्करी क़यादत से करनी है. क्या पाकिस्तान के हालात की वजह से आपको अस्करी क़यादत से फिर राब्ता करना पड़ा बिलाखिर?
That they've got to go and talk only to the right people. That is the Pakistan military establishment.
Well, I disagree with you on that. We were very, very categorical about making sure that we would have both the civilian leadership and the military leadership in the same room. So I don't know if you remember, there were a number of meetings where Hillary Clinton, Mike Mullen from our military, and even our intelligence leadership, at that time it was either Panetta or maybe David Petraeus, they would come to Islamabad to meet with Mr. Kayani, Mr. Jilani, Rabina Hanikar, that we would be in the room with all of the Pakistani leadership. So I take issue with your saying that we went just to one.
मेरे कहने का मतलब है कि आप मिलिट्री क़यादत से भी मिलते थे.
We did our best.
They were made that way.
Well, we did our best not to do that. We did our best from the American side, always to try to find how do we get everyone in the room so that we really know that everyone is on board with whatever could be worked on. That was the attempt, at least.
What did you get the feeling?
Aapki nazar mein Pakistan ki kharja policy ko kaun dekhta hai, kaun banata hai?
Were the master.
Well, we always felt that unless we had everyone in the room, it would be difficult. No, that's right. We wanted to make sure that we had the civilian government, the foreign ministry, the military, and the intelligence people at the same time.
So you thought that's the joint.
Iska matlab hai ki Pakistan ke kharja umur ke mamla sab idare mushtarka taur pe sambhalte hain.
And well, we had very good military to military contacts. We had
that's strategic,
and very important intelligence to intelligence contacts. But when it came to the political overall decisions, we worked very hard to make it integrated.
People in Pakistan are very critical.
Pakistani awam Pakistani siyasat mein America ki mudakhalat ko sakht napasand karti hai. Chahe wo Long March ho ya Joseph Takhar Chaudhry ki bahali, humne America safir America namayindon ko har jagah maujood paya. Kya siyasadan aapko bulate hain ya phir aap khud hi har mamle mein dakhlandazi karte hain?
Superpower, so you just step into it, you just take it for granted.
America always had a took the relationship with Pakistan very seriously.
Yeah.
And you know, it's funny when people are talking to me here, they say, you know, now we have turned, how do you feel that we have turned to the Chinese, right? And I say, look, one thing that we always tried to do, and this is something I did with Ambassador Liu, the Chinese ambassador, when I was here with him, we would go to the Pakistanis and say, aren't you a lucky country? You have two of the best friends, most powerful friends in the world,
yeah,
right? You shouldn't have to choose between mommy and daddy. You should love them both, right?
Okay.
Now, our style is very different. What people will always say about the Chinese, we like the Chinese, they don't give us lectures.
I won't accuse you because when I've gone through the discourses of Machiavelli and the Prince of Machiavelli, this is the way of the world, that's I understand.
Mm-hmm.
But when you say with the same breath, you know about the journalist freedom and stuff like this, what happened to you when Washington Post Jamal Khashoggi was killed and CIA has given the reports that the Saudi Crown Prince involved in it, your Senate has given a vote about it, but the US President just said, is it not embarrassing that he said, oh, we have got such a billions deal with Saudi Arabia and to hell with all the freedom of journalism and ethics and whatever it is.
Well, I would only give that illustration that you've given exactly as the proof. There is a big debate in the United States. Who was on the cover of Time magazine? Who was the man of the year? Khashoggi.
Yeah.
Okay. So, is America saying we don't care? Now, America.
नहीं ये तो लोगों की राय है मगर आपकी हुकूमत का मौकफ तो कुछ और है.
But America is not just one person. And America, in America, we always have fights. We hope that they stay in the political realm. We always have fights about these things, but we take them seriously. We're not saying everyone has to be like us. But I'm saying, do appreciate the fact that we take these values seriously and we, you know, Khashoggi, we expose it to the world.
Khashoggi is not a political case. It's an excellent case of human rights.
Mm-hmm.
People look towards America as the beacon of justice, you know.
Right.
But you should have stood by, you should have talked to the Crown Prince instead of acknowledging him. How could he be standing next to all these great leaders of West and America when he has wrenched his hands with the blood of Khashoggi, allegedly, you know?
It's a very big issue, as you know, in the United States. There's a huge debate about this, and I'm very proud of that debate. There are different sides on the debate, but believe me, this debate is not closed, right? And I would love to see that debate in other countries. I see it in Europe. I would like to see it more in other countries of the world. But the point is, we have these debates on the open. Whether we live up to our aspirations, you can judge. But we try.
When you and the massive human rights violation by the Saudi government against their own people, you just don't say a single word about it.
I'm saying we're saying more about it. You say you don't say a single word about it. We're saying more about it than anybody.
On the Saudi regime?
On all of the kinds of things. Have you read the American newspapers? Have you listened to the debates in Congress?
The newspapers, they stand by to the principles of, you know, justice and whatever. They're right. They're standing by the Washington Post, the Daily. They all go all the way for Khashoggi,
exactly.
And I admire them.
Right.
I'm talking about the U.S. government's policy.
Right. So the point is,
support
that fight,
suffocation
that fight,
and human rights violation over there.
That fight is going on in our government, and I am proud of that fight. I'm proud of the fact that in America we care about those kinds of things. I wish that kind of fight were going on all over the
because,
world.
Because you know, when you have dual standards of justice and mm-hmm. humanity, then people mm-hmm. don't trust you.
But you're trying to say that one side of the fight is the only side. And this is a kind of a black and white painting that I think is incorrect. In America, there are debates over women's rights. In America, there are debates over the future of environment. You know, there are many people in the United States who are very strongly supporting the Paris Accords for the environment. There are still many Americans who very strongly support the JCPOA with Iran. Mm-hmm. We have the diversity of opinion, and we work those things out in public. I'm very proud of that.
Okay.
اب ہم واپس پاکستان کی طرف آتے ہیں اور ہم نے یہ منظرنامہ دیکھا کہ ڈو مور تھنگ جو ہے اوباما بش اور اب ڈونلڈ ٹرمپ تک یہی گردان چلتی جا رہی ہے پاکستان اس بات کا دعویٰ کرتا ہے کہ ہم نے امریکہ کی جنگ میں 14 سالوں کے دوران 74,000 پاکستانی جانوں کا نقصان برداشت کیا ہمارا بلینز کا نقصان ہوا لیکن ہمیں اس جنگ سے کچھ بھی حاصل نہیں ہوا کچھ فائدہ نہیں ہوا 9/11 ٹوئن ٹاورز گرے اس میں پاکستان کو لینا دینا ہی نہیں تھا سعودی فیملی اور سعودی دہشت گرد اس میں شامل تھے ان لوگوں کو تو آپ نے خیر باہر نکال دیا امریکہ سے سیفلی ہمارا جن کا ان سے کوئی تعلق ہی نہیں تھا ہم پر جنگ آ پڑی کیونکہ افغانستان کے ہم پڑوسی تھے ہمیں آپ نے جنگ میں دھکیل دیا جو آپ نے طالبان کے خلاف شروع کر رکھی تھی اس جنگ میں ہمارا $123 بلین نقصان ہوا لیکن پھر بھی جب امریکن صدر ڈو مور کا مطالبہ کرتے ہیں تو یہ تو بڑی عجیب سی بات لگتی ہے پاکستان پر یہ بلا جواز
and it's all, you know, someone coming from the outside. Look, there's plenty that we need to talk about. And again, when I describe what we were trying to do with the combined dialogue, the efforts that I associate with Richard Holbrooke, it was to get away from this dialogue of who is the victim and who is doing bad things. It's how do we work together? Where is our common ground? And so, with all due respect, I think that putting it that way is not constructive. What I'm here to do for East West and as an American, as a friend of Pakistan, is to figure out how do we change the subject to talk about the things that we want to do together rather than trying to figure out you are responsible for this, you are responsible for this. We're not going to get anywhere with that. I would love to see us working hand in hand because, if I can add, I was a diplomat in many countries, but I'm not kidding you when I say I felt more personal affinity, more comfort with Pakistani people than anywhere else that I served. Americans and Pakistanis.
With the US people, that's not an issue.
Exactly. Yeah. And I get along with people, and we have a very, very talented and successful diaspora of Pakistani Americans. I would love to focus on those things. I'm not saying we can pretend the other things don't happen, but it's just let's be winners. Let's make this work rather than keeping pulling up the issues about the feelings of betrayal and the feelings of disappointment, because they're there on both sides.
Okay. اگر آپ پاکستان کے پوائنٹ آف ویو کو وکٹم کارڈ سمجھتے ہیں تو میں آپ کو دوسرے اینگل سے بات کرتا ہوں میں ڈونلڈ ٹرمپ کے ٹویٹس کا حوالہ دوں گا جس میں انہوں نے کہا کہ امریکہ نے احمقانہ انداز میں پاکستان کو پچھلے 15 سالوں میں $33 بلین کی امداد دی مگر پاکستان نے ماں سوائے دھوکے کے کچھ نہیں کیا ہمیں دھوکہ دیا اگر آپ کا یہ موقف قبول کر لیں تو تصویر کا دوسرا رخ جو میں سمجھتا ہوں وہ یہ ہے کہ پاکستان نے اس دنیا کی سب سے بڑی سپر پاور امریکہ کو بیوقوف بنایا اور ان سالوں میں پاکستان نے ہر چیز امریکہ سے لی مگر جواب میں کچھ بھی نہیں دیا آپ کو صرف بیوقوف بنایا گیا
Is this the narrative more acceptable for you? You're making a very good point, which is the way to deal with this is not to say you took advantage of us or we took advantage of you. The way for us, I agree with you. The way for us to deal with this is to say, in which ways do we have common ground? I've been encouraged that actually recently, it seems there may be some openings for the Prime Minister perhaps to meet with the President. Mm-hmm. That would be a good start. But you're right, we should not deal with this, we get nothing, you get everything. I think where we find is there's an enormous possibility here for common work, and I'd love to foster that. I'd love to do whatever I can and to encourage my friends to try to see what we can do to build.
That's very appreciable. But you know, many people also believe that you've got 1,40,000 NATO forces over there, including the US one, in Afghanistan. You've spent more than $1 trillion on that war. You lost it miserably over there. I was just reading the newspaper the other day, 2 days ago, and Taliban struck and just killed more than 30 official people of Afghan government. Mm-hmm. With your presence, you did not actually eradicate them. Mm-hmm. Pakistan, after that school attack on the children of Pakistan, we have taken this war and terrorism head on. And you have seen the results now. There are no suicide attacks. We have just evaporated them from Karachi, from Balochistan, from these areas. So people say that US has lost, US failed to understand Taliban. And all, they have to put someone as a scapegoat, and that's the Pakistan, that's the neighboring country to Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. So is this also the way to interpret your defeat in Afghanistan, because you're not doing anything. You're asking for the negotiations with Taliban, and they refuse, and you're just waiting for them to initiate the dialogue. You're asking us mm-hmm. to do the dialogue.
Mm-hmm. I hope that Pakistan sees it in its interest that there can be no military solution to this war. And I think that's the position of the United States. It certainly has always been, I believe, the position of Pakistan. And we say it is not a favor that anyone does to anyone else, but that engaging in the dialogue is something that furthers Pakistan's interest in having neighborly relations, prosperity next door, and not a threat to the people of Pakistan.
Mm.
So in that sense, I think that the talks are not so much a question of someone doing someone a favor. I think it's very much in Pakistan's interest to do all it can, and I'm convinced that many people are doing that, as well as China, as well as Afghanistan, as well as America, to try to see what we can do to come to a solution that's good for everybody. That's where I think we should go.
I was reading Imran Khan's tweet, the Prime Minister, and he was telling US President that we won't be your hired gun now.
Mm-hmm.
No, I met him 2-3 times, and whenever he talks of US, he says that we want an equal sort of relationship with US, although we know that you're a superpower, but we also know that you need us.
Mm-hmm.
So we won't initiate your war now, we won't be a hired gun, and we'll talk to you at an equal level. So do you find, you have met Imran Khan today, do you find him to be a true leader like Tayyip Erdogan or Mao Zedong of Pakistan?
Well,
he's going to take relationships to another level with US?
I wish him the best. I hope that what will happen is that his effort to try to be a good friend of America is something that works out in the United States, that the government of my country will also deal with him in that way. But I think that the main thing that we want to focus on is that it's not a question of making a balance, you know, kind of keeping score. It's much more a question, and I think this question about hired gun is, what people want is respect. What people want is to be treated the way they would like to treat others.
Yeah, but does Mr. Trump believe that?
And that's the question. We'll see how this works. But I think we understand that this is an effort to try to, it's when we talk about equals, you make the point. America has a much larger economy, a much larger military than Pakistan. But you want to be treated with respect. And I think that is where we ought to be going. And I hope that is where we go. And that's what I respect about the Prime Minister. He wants to have that, and I really wish him well. Because in the long run, if he can figure out how to foster that with America, that allows us to do all the other things that I've talked about. You know, making sure your students have the opportunity to study in America, bringing American students here, making sure that our people can invest in what is a very dynamic economy. All those things that I want to see, I think that comes from the respect. Respect comes from knowledge and from contact, and we need a lot more of that.
What is the credibility of Imran Khan as compared to any other leader of Pakistan, particularly Zardari when he was in the power, Nawaz Sharif when he was in the power, to the U.S.? For U.S.?
You know, the United States...
Or is just another prime minister of Pakistan?
The United States is going through a period where it's looking inward.
Inward.
One of the things that's very important about understanding President Trump's foreign policy, in my opinion, is that domestic policy plays an enormous role. When you look at what's happening with Mexico, a lot of this is about the domestic constituency that elected President Trump. When you think about the Muslim ban, you know, this is a lot about the feelings that people have. And it's less about classical foreign policy than it is about how American domestic policy plays out overseas. So that's one way to look at that. So when you look at Imran Khan, it's hard to put it in a context of, is there a policy towards this or that or the
other? But how is he Imran different than Zardari and Nawaz Sharif?
But he is seen by those people who watch him. I believe he is seen as different.
He's
seen as a different type of person.
In which way?
In the way that the traditional organizations, the ones that we associate with, you know, PPP or PMLN, and the sense of the way that politics worked in this country, he is a person who at least rhetorically, at least the way he speaks, he's talking about a new departure. He's a different kind of guy. And in this way, he's similar to a lot of leaders around the world who are the people who say, we're not going to do that this way anymore. Now, whether those leaders succeed, it's a very mixed bag.
And do you think he's making decisions by himself? Sorry.
No, but my point is that he is seen as different. The question is whether, you know, different is one thing.
Different in terms? Because one more point to get it clarified. Different in terms of he is making the independent shots while he's dealing with America, while dealing with India, Afghanistan issue, or still Pakistan's establishment is actually dealing youth?
The difference is that I think that he has a different style.
And what is that style?
And that style is the style, he's very charismatic, right? The language that he uses, that is anti-corruption, clean government, you know, it's kind of a new rhetoric. It's not the language that people have used in the past. People are waiting and seeing.
But he's at the helm of the affairs, he's firing the shots?
You know, the thing is, if the question you're asking is, you know, is he in charge or not?
Yeah.
That's something I don't know. I just don't know.
What is U.S. perception of
it? But the U.S. perception is, let's see what he can do. Let's look for results, rather than trying to figure out what's happening in the black box.
Because, you know, if
we want to see results, rather than coming up with conspiracies.
Yeah, but if you read through the opposition...
The conspiracy stuff, this is not what it seems. To me, that's very dangerous, because it takes us away from the real problems.
Okay.
Can he succeed in the fiscal and financial problems he has? They're very important. Let's measure that. Can he succeed in, say, reform of taxation in this country? Can he succeed on these things? I think if we get down to the real stuff, rather than trying to figure out what's happening behind the curtain, that's the constructive way.
He can succeed if you please don't object the IMF to scrutinize all the loan and to see whether they are going to be in terms of paying off to China and the debts to the China and stuff like this. If you just don't object to that and let IMF work independently, to save the image of IMF as well, for God's sake.
But, you know, the question about loans and the question of the IMF are really one level, but at the most fundamental level, the question is there going to be reform?
Okay.
Is there going to be reform in Pakistan? I look at Pakistan and I see a country that, in comparison to many other countries in the world, has not reached its potential. It's not a tiger you remember in the 1960s, I have heard stories, I don't know if they're true, Korea would send people here to learn from Pakistan. And now look at the Korean economy, right? That after Deng Xiaoping came into power, you know, they sent people here to Pakistan. And Pakistan has fallen behind. What this will take is reform.
My last question.
And people who like Pakistan want to see reform, and they wish Imran Khan well.
Mr. Trump suspended the military aid. Is there any point... will there be any point that they will probably reconsider it, according to your analysis, or they won't?
Very hard for me to say. Okay. I can only say that personally, I would like to see the focus of American interest in Pakistan have two new elements: a focus on civilian issues, civilian issues that Pakistanis care about, education, welfare, those kinds of things, and that the relationship is not just one of bilateral ties, but that we look at the whole region. I would love to see, if we can, to see progress that America and Pakistan make
question.
In Afghanistan, etc.
After such an aggressive attitude through tweets, Mr. Trump, then again, was there a change of heart when he sent the letter to Prime Minister and he said that we acknowledge your efforts and we need you to initiate the one peace talks?
Well,
or it was compulsion. Pentagon has told him that, what have you done? You've done the blunder.
I would have to ask you to ask Mr. Trump about what made
about
his,
the change of heart.
I don't read Mr. Trump's mind. I can only say that personally, I find it very cheering that it seems, for whatever reason, that he wants to engage. I think engagement is always right. Yeah. And so it's good, and let's hope that it leads
the
to
the last
well.
Question. Because
you have many last questions.
Just last question. It is the last question. You have been intervening in our affairs so much that I should ask you just one question about your affairs in America. What is the perception of Mr. Trump? You know, since he has taken the charge, dozens of his administration has just resigned him. Some of the people in the administration, they have just told that people in White House does not take him seriously. His files are just at the desk. You know, they don't even do any action on that because they thought they are not serious business. You know, so is this the perception he holds in American masses?
Can you repeat, just so I understand the question, that is the style of Mr. Trump?
No. But my question is that Mr. Trump's credibility among the American people, two dozens of his own administration people, you know, he has been important. They have just resigned or left him by themselves because they didn't like his style of leadership. One of the person who has left him, I just don't remember his name, he said that the staff at U.S. Oval Office, they don't even take his his actions seriously, what he has written, because they're out of this world, out of the box. Mm-hmm. So is this the credibility of US president in America or not?
There's a very, very interesting phenomenon going on that it would take us a very long time to discuss. But the only comment I can make about it is he represents a new kind of politics. His politics, in my mind, are the politics of his instincts rather than the politics, rather than the politics of traditional policy formation.
Okay.
So when I worked in the White House for President Clinton and I worked for the White House for President Bush, we would coordinate policy with the Treasury, with the State Department, the Defense Department. We would try to come and write the papers for our principals. We know that that process, which we call the interagency process, is not working as it did. This is because of the style of the president.
Okay.
But there are a number of people who chose to change things. They said, we don't want things to keep going the way they are.
But people took
and they chose, and they chose him, and there is still a chunk of people in the United States, it's not 50%, but it's still a chunk of people in the United States who support him. And I think, you know, what they think is that this guy is doing something different. Let's see what happens.
They took him seriously?
And I think that though his supporters take him very seriously.
آپ اس وقت ایسٹ ویسٹ انسٹیٹیوٹ کے چیف ایگزیکٹو آفیسر صدر ہیں ہمیں بتائیں گے کہ یہ ایسٹ ویسٹ انسٹیٹیوٹ کیا ہے اور آپ کا اس میں کیا کردار ہے کیا یہ تھنک ٹینک کی ادارہ ہے
It's like a think tank in the sense that what think tanks generally do is analyze problems of politics, analyze relations, and then try to do a study of them. We try to do something a little differently. Rather than reacting to the world problems, what we try to do is anticipate where there might be conflict.
Okay.
You know, if there's going to be a conflict in the Middle East, if we think that the US-China relations are important, or the future of Pakistan with its neighbors, then what we try to do is promote dialogue. And so what we're doing here is talking about what we're studying here, and I have board members from Pakistan, from India, from China, from Russia on my board. What we do is try to understand the problems, the issues that you and I will talk about, and try to see whether we can bring people together to build trust and come up with concrete solutions before the crisis happens. So that's the work of the East-West Institute. It's a private nonprofit that tries to do this globally.
So you become very important through this institute because Pakistan and US needs a dialogue. So what are you doing regarding that? You have met the Prime Minister Imran Khan as well.
For example, you know, part of the problem that I see between the US and Pakistan is that some of the problems we talk about are the same problems we've talked about for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
They're problems that there's been great misunderstanding about, mistrust, sometimes disappointment. And what I think we need to do and what I hope East-West can help with is to talk about the topics. It's not that, you know, these old topics are not important. Talk about the new topics. What is going to happen to the economy of Pakistan? How about its relations with its neighbors? How can the United States have a constructive role, maybe not from the government, but from business, from media, from universities, other things like that? How can the relationship between Pakistan and the United States develop in a positive way? That's what we're working on. I've talked about it with the Prime Minister. I've talked about it with business communities in Karachi and here in Islamabad. And I'm cheered that I think things are better than they were at the time when I was here.
It was a pleasure to have you, Mr. Munter.
Pleasure to be with you.